right now, we would like for you to raise a hallelujah with us. I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I'll raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Will arise. Death is defeated.
is Mother's Day, and we want to acknowledge all the women we're blessed to know. We rejoice over you, for your strength, your wisdom, your strong love, and your beautiful faith. Whether today is a celebration for you or a day of quiet reflection and healing, we're thinking of all of you. If you gave birth this year to your first child, our joy overflows and we celebrate with you. If you adopted a child this year or became a foster parent, we rejoice with you and we want to honor you in your commitment to changing the lives of children. If you continue to struggle with infertility, we're hoping with you and holding your hand in prayer. If you are exhausted and feeling underappreciated for all you do for a house full of kids, we applaud you. We love you, and we appreciate you more than you can ever imagine. And if you lost a child this year to death or miscarriage, we weep and mourn with you. And if your child is lost to addiction or to the world, we hurt with you. And we join you in putting our hope in the one who brings prodigals home. If you live with painful memories of your mom, we pray that you will find in a spiritual mother all that you never had from a birth mom. And if you're one of those amazing spiritual moms, we thank you for stepping up and being there when others couldn't. If you're experiencing an empty nest for the first time this year, we walk with you in this new season and are excited about the next chapter God has planned for you. If you're single, we celebrate your strength, beauty, and individuality, and join with you in praying for the desires of your heart. If you're a single mom and wonder if you have the physical energy and financial resources to raise and provide for your child or children, we want to help you, and we will. And if you're pregnant for the first time, we prayerfully anticipate with you the joyful birth of a healthy child. And to all the special women on this Mother's Day, rest and delight in knowing that we are thankful for you, and we celebrate each and every one of you.
To all you mothers out there, happy Mother's Day today. As you can probably tell, I am not Curtis. I am Bob Willis, senior pastor here at North Park Community Church. And I am so glad that you chose to spend this hour this morning with us. I was reading this morning about women of noble character. In fact, in Proverbs 31, verses 10 through 31, the end of the chapter, it speaks of a virtuous and noble wife and mother. And as I read that, I thought, hey, that's Mary Ellen. That's my wife right there. So Mary Ellen, happy Mother's Day. I love you and I appreciate you. You can go to our website, northparkchurch.org, and there are a plethora of ways that you can keep connected with us. But let me just mention one this morning. This last week, we began Zoom Bible studies on Tuesday and Thursday. There were several people, many people who were involved in those, and you can get in on that. Just go to our website, northparkchurch.org, and you can see how to do that, along with other opportunities like men's prayer, etc. We also, this last week, opened our food pantry here. It is open on Tuesdays and Thursdays between 10 and 2 p.m. If you personally, or if you know somebody that needs help with food, come on, we've got food for you. We want to help you out. It's in the youth room in the back building here. And like I said, it's open Tuesday and Thursday, 10 to 2 p.m. I also want to remind you all that we need to continue to pray for our missionaries, those who are serving in the United States and those who are serving overseas. It is very, very important that we keep them in our prayers. Some are going through extremely difficult times right now. Last week, we have a question of the week every week. Last week, the question was on favorite pineapple toppings, and we determined, or pizza toppings, and we determined that pineapple does not belong on pizza. And if you like pineapple on your pizza, you may need some professional care. I'm not sure. So today, that leads us to this week's question. If you're on YouTube or on Facebook, you can answer this question. Although pineapple does not belong on pizza, what is your favorite means of consuming pineapple? What's your favorite way to eat pineapple? Hey, here's Candi with the kids' moment.
Hey, kids, it's Pastor Candi here, and I am excited to be with you on this very beautiful day. Of course, I'm sure you've already told your mom Happy Mother's Day. When we get together on Sundays, usually during Mother's Day, we always make something for your mom. So today I thought I'm going to make something in honor of your mom. I decided I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to bake a cake for your mom. You know, moms are really special. And as I was getting all my ingredients together for my cake, I realized that when I put together the ingredients, I wonder if that's what God was thinking when he made moms. Because see, he had to put together all their characteristics and traits just to get it right for you, so that you had just the right mom. So for instance, when I take a look at this sugar, think of the right amount of love that your mom has. When we whip the butter and we put it in the mixer and we start mixing it up with the sugar, that it makes it nice and light and fluffy. It makes me think of how your mom is there to lighten the load for you. You know, when things get tough, she sits there and she pats you on the back. She's like your biggest cheerleader. She is there telling you how awesome you are. Next, we need to add the eggs. You know what we have to do with eggs? You have to whip them. Moms, they whip us into shape, and we need that. There's times that we need to be whipped into shape because maybe we don't make the right decisions. Thank goodness for that. Flour is like a base ingredient. You need the flour in just the right amount, because if you don't put enough flour in, you're gonna have a messy, runny cake. But if you put too much in, man, you're gonna have a really hard cake. And it's not going to taste very good because it's going to be really dense. Moms are our foundation. And with too little mom in our life, we're a runny mess. But when we have too much mom, then they're overbearing and we can't develop into who we are as unique individuals. And we're going to add in the salt. You know, salt adds just a little extra flavor and a little taste, just like your mom. Add the baking soda. Baking soda to me reminded me of wisdom. You know, God gave your mom wisdom so that she could help you out in making decisions and making choices and helping with knowledge. Your mom's there so that she can provide the wisdom that God's given her to give to you. And I think that's really an important quality for a mom. Now we need to add our milk. Milk, actually, when it soaks it all up, it reminds me of how your mom sits and listens to you. And she just soaks everything in that you're saying. And now the vanilla. The vanilla. You only need a little bit, but it's the extra added flavor, just like a mama. I just want to say that I'm excited that we're going to bake this cake and we're going to get it in the oven here. And I'll be right back with you in just a minute. And look at that. There we have a beautifully covered cake. Of course, we had to add our frosting onto it because the frosting is just pure white for the pure joy that your mom has having you as her child. And then we add the sprinkles because every mom deserves to have a little fun in her life and be spontaneous. And because you deserve a fun, spontaneous mom too. All right, so that is the basic ingredients of a cake and a mom. And here's what I'm gonna say. If you were to just take these ingredients and eat each of them on their own, they wouldn't taste good. Just like if you had a mom that was just full of all wisdom, but no love. Or just salty and not sweet. Or no fun. But God takes us all and he takes us and he molds us into just the perfect mom just for you. So I just want to say Happy Mother's Day to your moms, and may you enjoy the mom that God made for you.
All right. Well, thank you, Pastor Candi, for that great illustration. We always love your kids' moments. And happy Mother's Day to everybody out there who's watching, but especially to my mom and to my grandmother. I just want to say I love you and I appreciate you. And I'm so blessed that God chose you to be my mom and my grandma. I am not Pastor Bob. I am Pastor Rebekah Townsend. It's great to see you. Normally, I'm over leading the worship, but today I get to talk with you and read the word and study the word together with you this morning. And I have to tell you something before I even start. It is weird being in this room with very few people. North Park, we miss you so much. Your presence means the world to us. And so when all of this is over, just know we can't wait to hug you, to celebrate, to shout out our worship and pray with one another, hug one another. We are looking forward to that day with everything inside of us. And I'll tell you this, seminary doesn't prepare you for preaching to an empty room. And our pastor, Pastor Bob, has done an incredible job of adapting in really difficult circumstances that none of us were prepared for. And so I know that you send him notes of encouragement during the week often, but can I just encourage you to keep doing that? Because he is leading us so well through uncharted territory with such grace and such humility and such courage and bravery. And if we could all just say thank you and pray extra hard for him this week, that would be amazing. See, we find ourselves in a time where our lives have literally been turned upside down. Our lives have been interrupted. We are walking life interrupted. Schools, graduations, funerals, weddings, family gatherings, even our Mother's Day plans that maybe we had, travel, vacation, our businesses, our health, our economy, all of these things have just been interrupted by this crazy thing that is happening to our world. And interruptions are not fun. I don't know about you, but I'm a planner and I like to look down the road and know where I'm headed and mark out a path and move towards some goals. And this last week, as we were driving around as a family, I just had to look at my husband and say, I'm grieving. I feel sad because this is not the world that I wanted my children to be growing up in. I feel like our life has been interrupted. And as much as I've been trying to find the silver lining and the positivity and looking for what is it, God, that you have for me in this time, it's been really difficult. And so I just want to affirm that for you. If this morning you're watching and you've been feeling sad or you've been grieving the things that have been interrupted in your life, the Lord sees you and the Lord has a message for you today. See, how we handle interruptions in our lives tells us a lot about ourselves. And so a very natural human response is one that I just described as to grieve or to mourn the things that maybe have been interrupted or that we've lost in the interruption. Some other things that maybe we do are we become angry. I'm actually seeing a lot of anger bubble up in our world lately. It's starting to really simmer. People feel doubtful. They feel frustrated. You might even be struggling with depression or a sense of hopelessness. You might even find yourself unintentionally lashing out at other people, your family or people in the community or even online. And these are all really natural responses and understandably so because our lives have been significantly interrupted. When Ryan and I got married about 16 years ago, we were so excited. We actually were engaged for a long time, about a year and a half, and we had dated for a year and a half before that. And so we were so excited to get married. And so we planned out our wedding. We had a honeymoon all planned out. We were going to go to Mazatlan, Mexico, and we were so excited. And we didn't have very much money, but whatever money we had, we put into our plans for our honeymoon. And as the weeks approached the wedding, I was not feeling well, and I thought I had thrown my back out. And so I kept going to the chiropractor, and I kept getting adjusted, and nothing was getting better. In fact, I was getting worse, and I was losing a ton of weight. I think I actually weighed like 95 pounds on the day of our wedding. I was really sick. But the day came, and I was so excited, and nothing was going to stop us from getting married on the hottest day of the year, by the way, in 2003 in Santa Ana, California. And so we pushed through. I walked down the aisle. I met Ryan at the end of it. My dad gave him a good scolding about finishing school in front of everybody and God. And then we left the church and the reception, and we got on the road, and we traveled up to LA, and we were going to stay there for a couple of days before we got on the plane to go to Mexico. Well, our plans were interrupted. That night, my new husband of just a few hours had to put me in a car and drive me to an airport clinic where he was banging on the window because nobody was paying attention to us, saying, "My wife needs your help." See, I had doubled over in pain. I was very, very, very sick, and we didn't know what had happened. He thought maybe I'd burst my appendix or something. Well, long story short, we never made it to Mexico. Our plans for our honeymoon were totally interrupted by the fact that I had kidney stones, and I wound up spending the first 3 or 4 days of our wedding in a hospital bed, having surgery, and then the few days after that in my parents' house, and then another house with his parents. So you can imagine this was not how a young couple was thinking they were going to spend their first few days of wedded bliss. Our lives, our plans had been interrupted. Well, today our text is in Luke chapter 1, and I want to look at a story. We're going to look at actually Mary, the mother of Jesus, today on Mother's Day, and how her life and Joseph's life was interrupted. And we have the benefit of hindsight of looking back and going, well, that was the best interruption ever. It was Christ Jesus that came into your life. Well, she didn't have the benefit of knowing that back then. So let's look at our text together. Luke chapter 1, verse 26 says this. In the 6th month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end." Mary asked the angel, "But how can this happen? I am a virgin." The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her 6th month. For the word of God will never fail." Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." And the angel left her. So today we're going to look at Mary's response and the process that she goes through as she has had her life interrupted. Her first question that she asks is, "What? What? The angel just called me favored?" See, Mary was a young girl from a nowhere town called Nazareth. She was not affluent. She was young. And let's not forget, in a time that did not elevate women, she was a woman. she was not, by all accounts of by society, a favored person. And yet this angel, this representative of God, is saying, you are favored and the Lord sees you. See, I think sometimes we have a misunderstanding of what God's favor actually looks like. We think that it's unbroken happiness, it's pleasure, it's prosperity, it's things going according to our plan. It's having all of our ducks in a row. When actually, it's God's grace in our lives. It's his unmerited gift to us that we haven't earned, but that he gives to us so freely. And his grace is revealed in the things that are so desperately hard when our faith is put to a costly test. See, telling this young woman from Nowhereville's Nazareth that she's going to have a son had great implications for her life. She was already betrothed to Joseph. They already had a plan. And this potentially could undo all of their plans. This favor of God could undo everything that they were looking forward to. But see, Mary did not earn the favor of God. He chose to give it to her. He gave her his favor. Mary was simply to be the vessel to receive it. I came across this quote this week, and I thought it was really profound. It says, it is the lives that have been given something great to do and to bear, even though they may have been bruised in the process, which have truly known the favor of God. See, the favor of God in this case for Mary looked like this in verse 31. You'll conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end. The favor Mary is receiving is the very word of God, is that God is trusting her to carry his son. But Mary, her next question is, how? How in the world is this going to happen? And what does this mean? I'm a virgin. It makes no scientific sense. See, standing in the way of Mary being able to do this was cultural, scientific, practical, religious, and legal limitations. These huge barriers and walls. She was facing the impossible. And many of us today, we feel like we are facing the impossible. But see, it's at this point where we're facing our own insufficiency, where we do not have the answer to how, that we really get to be honest with ourselves. And if we're honest, each one of us would say, I can't do it on my own. We might need to actually change our question from how to who. I remember the night that I was diagnosed with cancer and I laid in bed and it was really the darkest night my soul has ever faced. And the questions that overcame me, that put me in a really dark place, were the how questions and the what questions. And it wasn't until the Holy Spirit came to me and renewed my mind and reminded me of who. That it had to be God, because I didn't have the answers. I didn't have the solutions. I was insufficient, but God was not. I want to invite you to stand where you are, and we're going to worship for just a moment and sing these truths in this song together.
Darkness tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know. Oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand. Chance when I stand in your love. eyes. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. No, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance.
Awesome. Thank you, worship team. So here's our third question. Who? Well, this passage tells us in verse 35 to 37, this is what the angel says. The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her sixth month, for the word of God will never fail. See, the angel tells Mary the answer to her question is God. God, by his Holy Spirit, will do it. Mary, in her insufficiency, comes face to face with the sufficiency of God. See, God will do it according to his power. He will fulfill his promises that he had made centuries before to his people, that he was going to send a Messiah, a Savior. And even if it seems impossible, God will do it. Because after all, the angel says, look what I've already done, what God has already done in your cousin Elizabeth. The miraculous has already happened. See, coming to grips with our own insufficiency allows us to come to the place of saying it has to be God. And this is the place of surrender. And this is the place where we have a choice to make. Will we, like Mary, say yes to God? As we deal with life's interruptions, as we face our own insufficiency, will we say yes to God? See, God has given us his son. He wants to trust us to carry his word, to carry his Holy Spirit with us wherever we go. just like he trusted Mary. And what's so incredible about Mary is her humility and her faith and her trust in God. Nothing else that she had achieved in life except to say, rightly so, I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said to me come true. Basically, I am God's servant. Let him have his way in my life. And so I ask you today, what is your response to God? What is your response in the face of interruption? What is your response in the face of the unknown? See, the thing is that God can handle our questions. He can handle us asking what and being bewildered and even afraid. God can handle us asking how. He can even handle us asking who, because the answer is always going to be that he will do it, that he will keep his promises. And what I love about Mary's response is that she goes from this, yes, let it be so, to praise. In this next passage of scripture, it's called Mary's Magnificat. You may have heard it. It's a beautiful song of praise. And this is what it says in Luke 1, 45 to 56. Oh, how my soul praises the Lord. How my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he took notice of his lowly servant girl. And from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the mighty one is holy, and he has done great things for me. He shows mercy from generation to generation to all who fear him. His mighty arm has done tremendous things. He scattered the proud and haughty ones. He has brought down princes from their thrones and exalted the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away with empty hands. He has helped his servant Israel and remembered to be merciful, for he made this promise to our ancestors, to Abraham and his children forever. See, Mary knew the promises of God, and she's recounting them and also celebrating that he is coming through on them. So as I conclude today, I just want to reiterate for you what Mary has said, just in a little bit different words. Mary says in her Magnificat, he sees me, God sees me, that is what makes me blessed. So today I say to you, God sees you, and that makes you blessed. God is mighty, and he has done great things for me. So I say to you, God is mighty. He has done great things for you, and he will do more great things for you. He scatters the proud and exalts the humble. So if you today feel broken and lonely, needy, God sees you, and he will exalt the humble. He is with the brokenhearted. And he fills the hungry to Jesus. I invite you to do that today. He sees you. He wants to be in relationship. You need God to come through for you. He is mighty. He has done great things. He will do them again. Maybe you are hungry spiritually, emotionally, physically. God can fill you up. And also, this church can. We have a food pantry. Literally, if you are physically hungry, if you are having a hard time of making ends meet right now, let us support you. And maybe you feel let down, disappointed, unsure of the future. I can tell you with total faith that God will keep his promises. And if you're wondering what those promises are, I encourage you to look to his word and see what they are. There are so many of them, and God is the keeper of promises. He will keep them, every one of them. I want to invite you to listen to this passage of scripture from Psalm 139, read by women in ministry from all over Fresno, and be blessed by the promises and the truth within it.
Oh Lord, you have searched me and known me.
You know when I sit and when I rise.
You perceive my thoughts from afar.
And you discern my going out and my lying down.
You know everything I do.
You know what I'm going to say even before I say it, Lord.
You go before me and follow me.
You lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain.
Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence?
If I go up to heaven, you are there.
If I make my bed in the depths, you are there.
If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea,
even there, your hand will guide me.
I could ask the darkness to hide me and the light around me to become night.
But even in the darkness, I cannot hide from you.
But the night shines.
Your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed.
And the days ordained for me were written in your book
before one of them came to be.
How precious to me are your thoughts, O God.
They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them.
They outnumber the grains of sand, and when I wake up, you're still with me.
O God, if only you would destroy the wicked.
Away from me, you who are bloodthirsty.
They speak of you with evil intent.
Your adversaries misuse your name.
Lord, can't you see how I despise those who despise you?
And abhor those who rise up against you, have nothing but hatred for them.
I count them my enemies.
Search me, O God,
and know my heart.
Test me, and know my anxious thoughts.
Point out anything in me that offends you.
And lead me in the way
everlasting.
Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. Never fails, will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high. Glorify, glorify the name of all. joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. Oh, all my days. Oh, yes, I will. For all my days. Oh, yes, I will.
Pastor Beckett, great job this morning. Thank you for speaking. You did so good. I was sitting down there thinking, well, maybe you should start preaching every Sunday and I should start leading worship. And then I figured that probably wasn't real wise. We want to leave you today with this prayer of benediction from Deuteronomy chapter, or Numbers chapter 6. It says, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace." Amen. North Park, have a great week. Can't wait till we can all gather together soon.